Buen día. Thank you very much. Rector Solá, Dean Favera. My attachment to Catalonia, to Spain, to this university goes back some way. I remember when, as a faculty member at the University of Minnesota, in the mid-late 60s, Antonio Bosque, Mascolet, Silvestre, showed up as graduate students at the university. Walter Heller, who was a great figure, great economist in the United States, was the chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors, had made visits to Spain, and he had obtained financing for some students. And there were these wonderful, perfect group of students who were able to take advantage of this. This money, in fact, came from a Greek named Andreas, so there's a world trade aspect to all of this. Later at Northwestern University, I had the great good fortune to again renew this this connection. When I arrived at Northwestern, there was Jordi Andreu, Salvador Barberá, Isabel Fredera, Javier Ruiz Castillo, and they were all actively engaged in their work and about ready to start writing a dissertation. So I supervised their dissertation, and that was a great honor and more great good fortune for me. Later at Princeton, there were further Spanish students coming to the United States, and in particular, I remember reading the application files for Zubiri and San Segundo that were sent. I remember the first time I had Angulas here. I remember walks on the Gran Vía. I remember we were trying to track this down quite precisely, but in 1976, going to the first open meeting of the Socialist Party outside in a stadium, a football stadium, as I recall. I remember the oposiciones of my students and how fearful they were of this experience and how all of this changed over time in important ways. And I remember the good and wonderful economics that I was able to do with these people and the personal and wonderful friendships that I formed here. It's a privilege to be more formally attached to your university, a great honor and something that I will forever be very proud of. The talk that I'm going to give is, in fact, a serious talk. It's not a talk about economics, it's a talk about universities. And my intention is to be provocative, to give you my best thinking on an issue. I'm going to say some things that are, in fact, somewhat more difficult to say in the U.S., I suppose. Being away, I feel strangely a bit more relaxed and a little bit bolder. As was going on in the seminar that we just came from, I expect criticism and I expect people to take what I'm saying seriously and to talk about these things. So I have recently become president of a university in the United States, the University of Chicago. Rector Solá and I are in a similar position. Among my students, I think we now count four deans or former deans, people who were doing science administration in important ways, public figures, people working in the private sector, people working in universities, people working in important government positions. So many of you will have the opportunity to matter in the areas that I'm speaking about. In taking on my responsibilities as a university president, I feel with considerable force the obligation to serve my institution well and also to be of service to the larger society. And so I find myself from time to time wrestling with the following kinds of questions. What is my university expected to accomplish? What do its faculty and students expect of it? What does society expect of it? How can my university, or all universities collectively, best promote the social good? And I should emphasize that there are different types of universities, and they have different roles. I don't want to suggest that what I'm going to speak about is a model for all of them. I'm really speaking about what's called, in my country, the research universities. The questions that I pose do not have easy answers. And urgent matters of the day, and we're often called to address the urgent matters of the day, can easily leave us with too little time to consider these questions. However, I'm absolutely convinced that leaders of higher education have a responsibility to think carefully and speak about these questions. It is imperative that our research universities have a clear sense of what they are trying to do and how they intend to accomplish their missions. And faculty leave this dialogue to administrators at their peril. Faculty should be thinking about these things too, as should students. Perhaps I should say at the outset that I worry a bit about the answers I'm inclined to give to these questions. For the purposes of our universities, as I would describe them, are much more limited than is currently conceived by popular opinion, at least in my country. Thus, there is the possibility that my university will suffer in some respect, that it might be viewed as unimportant or even uncooperative when the public hears how narrowly I would define its purpose. And there is certainly a possibility that my remarks will be seen as self-serving, since a narrow definition of the university's purpose makes it in some ways easier to achieve success under such a definition of purpose. To these points I respond that the purpose I would ask our great universities to serve, research universities to serve, though more narrow than the purposes suggested by others, are in my judgment of vital importance and not at all easy to accomplish. Furthermore, I would hold our universities to the highest standards in terms of how well these purposes are accomplished. So let me speak now about what I see as the purpose of universities, or at least the research university. A primary task of universities is the discovery, preservation, and transmission of knowledge. We are concerned with the most fundamental questions. How did the universe begin? How did life begin? How is life passed from generation to generation? What are the building blocks of matter? What is our history? What does it teach us about the future? How have cultures evolved? How has language evolved? How is society best organized in order to promote the social good? Some of these are questions that economists and people in the audience have addressed. What is the social good? What is moral, just, and fair? What of courts and constitutions? How do people learn? How do they think? What is the role of convention in the organization of societies? We analyze literature, music, and works of art, and we look for patterns and parallels within and across cultures. But perhaps more important than the subject matter of our inquiries, more important than appreciation for the works of the mind, develop the skills of the intellect, emphasize the continuing need for free inquiry and discussion, the importance of scientific discovery, the need to understand the non-rational. Thus, they have stood for the concept of the wholeness of knowledge and for the morality of that intellectual criticism which is so difficult because it is self-criticism, requiring the admission of error. They have helped to create a thoughtfulness about values. He continues, it is true that this is an idealized picture, but it describes the central thrust carried forth at particular times by enough scholars at enough institutions to have had a pervasive influence. And I should, that's the end of the quote, I should emphasize that this is a distinguished former university president, but it's also a person of the world. This gentleman was the former attorney general, is the former attorney general of the United States. At this point, you may be puzzled In my introduction, I spoke of narrow university purpose and suggested a kind of modesty. But this was followed by a rather grandiose description of the questions considered at our universities. How did life begin? How did the universe begin? And perhaps an equally grandiose description of the life of the mind. Allow me then to expand upon my vision of the appropriate role of the university by contrasting it with some current views of what a university should be expected to do. Universities are charged with responsibility for increasing the rate of economic growth. They are asked to create the knowledge that will lead to new or revitalized industries and to teach students the particular skills that will make them attractive candidates for jobs in those industries. Universities are expected to be resources to solve societal or national problems, preserving the environment, securing the national defense, curing AIDS, reducing the incidence of teen pregnancies, combating welfare dependency, helping restore a sense of social purpose. Universities are charged with responsibility for bringing together people of different racial, ethnic, and social backgrounds, creating an atmosphere in which barriers will be stripped away and mutual understanding and respect will flourish. Universities are supposed to be comfortable, even fun, places for students to be secure and at ease. They are expected to have attractive dormitories, good food, outstanding recreational and social facilities, national class athletic teams to cheer for, concerts and dramatic performances, expert career and personal counseling, and faculty who are devoted to students' personal growth. Universities are expected, through a prescribed set of mandatory courses, to furnish students with a body of knowledge that defines a well-educated man or woman. Universities are expected to produce good citizens, law-abiding taxpayers with a deep sense of civic responsibility. Great universities are expected to acquire and to preserve extensive and comprehensive libraries, great art collections, and examples of outstanding architecture, not necessarily sized or shaped to fit with the particular scholarly or teaching activities of the university. All of this leaves me with a fearful image of universities competing to meet all of these various expectations, many of which are quite worthy. Don't misunderstand me. The list is one that's full of things that we want to do. They're good. They're important. Some are of more questionable value. Some you may even consider to be of negative value. But none, I believe, are primary purposes of a great university. I am concerned about the prospect of a world, or at least a nation, where the reputations of universities are derived from the expert opinions offered by their faculty on topics of the day, frequently on television talk shows, frequently in 30-second sound bites. Universities defined by schools and centers seeking to solve the most pressing social problems. To promoting national economic growth. Universities whose students assiduously acquire the knowledge that is claimed to define the educated person. Universities whose libraries, museums, athletic events, and concerts are all world-class. Places that pretend that the true work of the university is less than difficult and often painful. Places that pretend that the true work of the university, though frequently joyful, is not infrequently disturbing. Places that pretend that the societal benefits that they convey will be reaped quickly. In short, places that fail to recognize that a university primarily exists to address the most fundamental problems and questions, to promote the tradition of the life of the mind, the skills of the intellect, the need for free inquiry and discussion, the importance of scientific discovery, and thoughtfulness about values. Lest you think that the concerns that I'm expressing are overblown, Let me share with you two current examples of the difficulties universities in my country face in staying true to their basic mission of discovery and sharing discovery. Today in my country, when decisions are made about the funding of university scientific research, there are powerful, perhaps even overwhelming, political pressures favoring research that claims to produce results that will be immediately beneficial, or very quickly beneficial to society. These forces are much stronger than they were during the Cold War or when the United States was poorer. At a time when we should have more resources for the less pressing problems, we apparently view ourselves as having less. Another example, this one in the form of a simple test. Count the number of university requests for funds made to state legislatures, the federal government, or to alumni that explain the purpose of the university as I have described the purpose of a university. Now count the number of such requests that appeal to economic progress, to increased competitiveness with other institutions or nations, or to the achievement of particular social agendas. I would venture that the latter types of requests, or the latter rationales, far outnumber the former. Now, don't misunderstand me. Let me pause for a moment. Fundamental in the way that I look at the world and my hope for universities is that the idea that the basic belief that discovery and truth will improve the human condition, that by looking for the truth, we replace prejudice. Truth is the purpose of a university, not the importance of the ideas. Importance matters, but not first looking for important ideas. It's looking for truth, because truth is important. In the professional schools at the research universities in my country, and in my own university, we have outstanding schools of medicine, law, business, and social services, one has a part of the university where there is a hope that more directly the results will improve the human condition. Applications may in fact be more important than truth and discovery. I'm not speaking strictly about importance. In our medical school, we work on the health of the children in our neighborhood. It's extraordinarily important. It's extraordinarily immediate. But the purpose of a research university is truth, and one needs some kind of faith that the truth will make the world better. Let me continue now. Just as it would be a mistake to underestimate the pressure on universities in the United States to turn away from what I regard as their primary purposes, and I tried to describe these pressures, it would be equally wrong to believe that our universities have completely lost their way or to underestimate the remarkable strength and durability of these institutions. The great universities in my country, by and large, demand very high levels of scholarly excellence from their faculty, and the faculty continue to demand such excellence of themselves. Scholarly work that panders to what is popular is usually understood and unmasked for what it is. Our undergraduate and graduate schools are quite properly the envy of the world, and students continue to flock to our strongest academic programs. Our universities command impressive resources and are home to important research libraries that are in fact used and appropriate, and world-class scientific facilities exist in these institutions. Still, I cannot avoid being concerned that the massive difference between what universities claim they can deliver, or at the very least what they let society imagine they can deliver, and what they actually can and should deliver, could in the long run prove very injurious, even to our most distinguished and financially secure institutions. The damage thus inflicted on our great universities would not be quickly apparent. The faculty and students at Harvard, Berkeley, the University of Chicago, and other outstanding institutions are simply too good and too committed to scholarly excellence to allow for any quick decline. For example, faculty rewards may become somewhat more dependent on external and popular reputations and less on one's scholarly reputation and depth of contribution. Faculty work may be expected to pay off faster. Ideas that have commercial utility may become both more prized and more closely guarded. Also, students may come to be viewed and to view themselves more as customers to be pleased quickly when making the purchase, as opposed to being helped to fashion a rope that will last them for a lifetime. My remarks should be taken as a warning, not as a prediction. For I join you here today with great faith in the ability of our universities to remain focused on their central mission, and with a large measure of optimism in the future of our universities. I am surrounded at this moment by students who have enriched my life and in whom I have enormous confidence. The process of thinking with them, watching them grow, learning from them has fed and it has strengthened my optimism. Anyone familiar with their devotion to scholarship, their attitudes, the attitudes they're instilling in their own students will understand my optimism. So will anyone who has been privileged to work in an environment where ideas and the sharing of ideas are what matters most. Universities should be places where we can think hard and independently about the ideas that are most important and which are most likely to change the way that we view our history, our humanity, and our opportunities for the future. They should be places full of men and women committed to finding the truth, to developing better explanations and deeper understanding. People who believe that thought and discovery will serve, more often than not, to improve the human condition. Universities should also be places of intellectual dissent. This is particularly important because new thinking is inevitably dissent from the orthodox. Universities should be places of community where we listen to each other's ideas and where we criticize. They should be places where faculty share with students the life of the mind, its joys, its hard work, its discipline, and building of character, so that a piece of the scholarly attitude will remain with these students for a lifetime. All of this is what I believe universities are most fundamentally about. And I believe as well that in order to adhere to this mission, we will need more, many more faculty and administrators at our universities who are dedicated to these purposes, are guided by them, and are prepared to speak out on their behalf. I conclude now. I hope that this image of the proper role of the university, or to be more precise, the role of the research university, resonates with you, and that you will think about how it applies and the lessons that can be drawn from it in the context of your own institutions, your own country. Again, my many thanks for allowing me to join the graduates of your university. My thanks for your hospitality to my wife, Elizabeth, and to me, hospitality over the years to our family. I'm honored, and I thank all of you, every one of you, for being here and for making this occasion so very memorable. Thank you very much.